Thank you. Good afternoon. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. I'm Alex Pollock of AEI, and it's my pleasure to welcome you to our discussion of Peter Wallison's new book, Hidden in Plain Sight: What Really Caused the World's Worst Financial Crisis and Why It Could Happen Again. This book, as I look at it, is a detailed, disciplined argument for the prosecution, with Peter as the prosecuting attorney and the United States government as the defendant in the dock. Will the prosecution prevail? Will the jury, that is history, bring in a verdict of guilty as charged, Your Honor? Well, it should. Of course, the government was not intending to create a financial collapse. It required lower lending standards it implemented through Fannie Mae and Freddie Mac, were, as Peter says, intended to assist low-income borrowers. But you're not doing people a favor by making them loans they cannot afford. Just the opposite, of course. To his credit, even that erstwhile political promoter of Fannie and Freddie, former Congressman Barney Frank, of the Dodd-Frank Act, finally concluded it was a great mistake, as he said, to push lower-income people into housing they couldn't afford and couldn't really handle once they had it. Part of this lesson even got reflected in President Obama's speech on housing last week. "Don't buy what you can't afford," the president counseled, sounding refreshingly conservative. He continued, "We're not going down the road again of financing folks buying things they can't afford." But it looks like, under political direction, Fannie and Freddie may be precisely going down that road once again. Our author and prosecuting attorney, Peter Wallison, holds the Arthur F. Burns Chair in Financial Policy Studies at AEI, where he co-directs the program on financial policy studies, and writes frequently and provocatively on an exceptional range of financial issues. Peter was a member of the Financial Crisis Inquiry Commission, which comes in for failing grades in the new book. Previously, Peter was White House counsel for President Reagan, general counsel of the U.S. Treasury Department, and practiced banking and financial law at Gibson, Dunn & Crutcher. He's written a number of books, of which my favorite is Ronald Reagan, The Power of Conviction and the Success of His Presidency. On today's issues, Peter also wrote Serving Two Masters Yet Out of Control, about Fannie and Freddie. Of course, today, Fannie and Freddie have only one master, the Federal Housing Finance Agency, standing in for the administration. Peter also wrote Privatizing Fannie, Freddie, and the Federal Home Loan Banks, which unfortunately hasn't happened quite yet. Today, he will present Hidden in Plain Sight. For those of you who don't yet have it, here it is, and it will be on sale in the reception immediately following our conference. And after you buy a copy, Peter will be available to autograph it. Ladies and gentlemen, Peter Wallison.
Thank you, Alex. That was, again, another overly generous introduction. They seem to happen too often. I think you should really have me standing behind a curtain. You can draw the curtain aside, and there's this little guy in there named the Wizard. In any event, it is wonderful that all of you are here, and I do hope you'll have an opportunity to read the book. I think that the book says some things that are important to be said about the financial crisis. As someone told me just a little while ago, it sort of resets the story about the financial crisis, and that's what we want to do. We want people to understand that something else happened other than the traditional story that we have heard since 2008. Now, we all know that the 2008 financial crisis was caused by a mortgage meltdown. At the default, there were a number of defaults, an enormous number of defaults of subprime loans. What most people don't know, however, is how many subprime loans there were, why they were made, and why the mortgage meltdown occurred to create a financial crisis. The book I'm presenting today is intended to provide answers to these questions. The conventional narrative about the crisis is that the private sector, Wall Street banks in particular, were not sufficiently regulated. This is a simple and irresistibly attractive story for the media. It involves greed by people already grossly overpaid, risk-taking with public funds, and bailouts of big banks while homeowners were evicted. And it's become a narrative repeated again and again in the media and by members of the Obama administration. In last Sunday's Times, for example, Gretchen Morgenson wrote this about efforts to reform the Dodd-Frank Act. "It is remarkable," she said, "to watch the same financial institutions that wrecked the nation's economy work to heighten risks in the system." And last week, Treasury Secretary Jack Lew wrote in an op-ed, "It is hard to understand the efforts of some to undermine our ability to protect consumers and taxpayers from excessive risks taken by financial institutions." The facts, however, tell an entirely different story. On June 30, 2008, before the financial crisis, there were 55 million mortgages in the United States. Of these, 56%, 31 million mortgages, were subprime because the borrowers had very low credit scores, very low credit records. That's a subprime loan. And otherwise, there were several other kinds of mortgages that were also risky because the mortgages had very low down payments or other kinds of deficiencies. That's 56% of all of the mortgages outstanding. Of these 31 million mortgages, 76% were on the books of government agencies, principally Fannie Mae and Freddie Mac, but also FHA, the Veterans Administration, and some other government agencies. I have a slide that shows where all these mortgages were, and it actually worked. There it is. This can only mean one thing, that the government, not the private sector, created the demand for these loans. Here's another fact. After Fannie and Freddie became insolvent in 2008 and was taken over by its regulator as conservator, it began to disclose its losses. In August of 2009, it reported that 81% of its losses in 2008 came from subprime and other risky loans that it held or had guaranteed. Freddie Mac later reported similar numbers. Now, this tells us a lot. If the vast majority of the losses suffered by Fannie and Freddie came from subprime and other risky loans, it was mortgages of this kind that caused the crisis, caused the losses that caused the crisis. And if 76% of these loans were on the books of government agencies, it follows that the government was responsible for the vast majority of the losses. It also follows that the private sector was responsible for only 24% of the losses, the difference between 100% and 76%, 24%. Who then wrecked our economy or created excessive risks? This is not a defense of the banks or the private sector generally, although some will persist in seeing it as such. Nor is it partisan. HUD in both, as the book makes clear, HUD in both the Clinton and George W. Bush administrations implemented the same destructive policies. Instead, the book is an effort to set the record straight, to make sure that the American people actually know what happened in the financial crisis, not the story that the media and the government like, but what the facts actually tell us. Why is it important that these facts be made known? I see several reasons. First, the false narrative was responsible for the enactment of the Dodd-Frank Act, easily the most restrictive regulatory law since the New Deal, which in turn has slowed the growth of the economy. Although unemployment has recently fallen, we are still in the midst of the slowest economic recovery since the 1960s. And that's because, instead of focusing on economic growth, We made the financial sector the whipping boy for the financial crisis. We focused on punishing financial firms for failing without actually investigating why they failed. The book makes clear that none of the reasons advanced in the conventional narrative withstands analysis. For this reason, I've always written, and I say in the book, that the Dodd-Frank Act is illegitimate. It is based on a false narrative and was enacted without any serious investigation of the real causes of the crisis. In addition, if we have the wrong idea about what caused the crisis, we are likely to make the same mistakes again. This is already happening. Last week, the president proposed to reduce the premium that FHA can charge for insuring mortgages. Now, FHA is a government agency that insures mortgages for people who can't meet conventional mortgage standards. Because these mortgages are risky, FHA must charge more for its insurance in order to cover its inevitable losses. Lowering the premium for these FHA insurance policies both increases FHA's losses and the number of subprime mortgages that FHA will ultimately have to cover. That's exactly how government agencies came to own 76% of the subprime mortgages in 2008. If the American people and their representatives knew that this was the case, there would have been an outcry when the president proposed to lower FHA premiums. If the president and his political advisors thought that there would be an outcry, they might not have done it. It's because the American people don't understand how government policies caused the financial crisis that the same thing is happening again. And I should mention that when the cycle turns and we head into a recession, who suffers the most? Clearly, it's the family that will be evicted, and those families turn out most often to be those the government helped. In his introduction, Alex talked about the statement by Barney Frank, which is very eloquent on this subject, and it's important to understand that Barney Frank was the principal proponent of the policies that caused the financial crisis from my perspective. And he said, and I'll repeat it again, it was a great mistake to push lower income people into housing they couldn't afford and couldn't really handle once they had it. That was his statement in 2010, after it became clear what was happening to the mortgages that were made under the government policies that I'll talk about in a minute. Finally, when the government takes losses on defaulted mortgages, the taxpayers aren't the only ones who are hurt. Every mortgage that fails and every eviction that occurs drives down the value of every house in the neighborhood. In other words, all Americans suffer when the government increases the likelihood of defaults and lowers underwriting standards, encouraging weak mortgages. Okay, so how did government policies cause the crisis? Let's begin at the beginning. Fannie and Freddie, the two government-backed firms that dominate the mortgage markets, do not make loans themselves. They buy loans from banks and other originators and either hold them in a portfolio or they securitize and sell them. Before 1992, Fannie and Freddie would buy only prime mortgages. These typically required at least a 10% down payment, a low debt-to-income ratio, and a solid credit history. Because Fannie and Freddie's insistence on prime loans, the market was relatively stable before 1992, with default rates below 1%. Yet even during this period of prime underwriting standards, the home ownership rate in the United States was 64%, where it had been, incidentally, for 30 years, and where it is again today after all the foreclosures and evictions that came out of the financial crisis. In 1992, however, Congress adopted the affordable housing goals, in order to increase mortgage credit for low-income borrowers. The goals imposed quotas on Fannie and Freddie when they bought mortgages from banks and other originators. At first, these quotas were modest. They required that when Fannie and Freddie bought mortgages, 30% of those mortgages had to have been made to borrowers who were at or below the median income in the places where they lived. Now, this was not a tough standard, but the authority to administer the goals was given to the Department of Housing and Urban Development. And over the years, after 1992, HUD gradually raised the goals from 30% to 50% in 2000 and 56% in 2008. This is a table prepared by FHFA, the regulator of Fannie and Freddie, and you have to look at it in detail eventually, but, and of course in the book, but if you look at it, you can see how year by year the goals were increased, not only for Fannie and Freddie and moderate and low-income borrowers, but also for other special borrowers who were lower than low-income or were minorities. This was the standard that Fannie and Freddie had to follow. When more than half of the mortgages they were required to buy had to have been made to borrowers below the median income, it was impossible to find enough prime mortgages to comply with the goals. Fannie and Freddie had to reduce their underwriting standards. By 1995, they were accepting loans with 3% down payments. That sounds familiar because just a few weeks ago, FHFA told Fannie and Freddie they could reduce their underwriting standards to accept a 3% loan, a 3% down payment loan. HUD also reduced FHA's underwriting standards, putting them in competition with Fannie and Freddie for the same low-income borrowers. That's how, by 2008, 76% of the subprime and other risky loans in the U.S. financial system ended up on government balance sheets like FHA and Fannie and Freddie. But that's not all. The huge influx of new mortgages, helped by government-backed leverage, built an enormous bubble. There it is. This is based on Bob Shiller's data, and you can see the size of that bubble in relation to the most recent bubbles in 1979 and 1989. When housing bubbles grow, defaults decline because the home is worth more than it was when it was bought, and people who can't meet their mortgage obligations are usually able to refinance. With few defaults, the market looked safe, and many commentators believed that the risks of subprime loans were actually pretty low. Moreover, Fannie and Freddie did not disclose how many subprime and other risky loans they bought. They said in SEC filings their exposure to subprime loans was, quote, minimal, or in some cases, less than 1%, when in fact, it was 17%. Their managers have since been sued by the SEC for these false statements. The failure of Fannie and Freddie to disclose how many subprime and other risky loans they held misled everyone. And I'm talking here about market analysts, regulators, risk managers at firms, and investors. They were misled about the riskiness of the housing market as 2008 approached. All of this accounts, at least in part, for the growth of private sector investment in subprime and other risky mortgages. With 2020 hindsight, after the financial crisis, it's easy to say that the private sector were taking excessive risks. Given the information in the market at the time, however, it's not so clear. In other words, there is a reasonable case that the government's actions lured the private sector into perdition. And there was one other factor at play when the bubble burst. Most of the mortgages held by banks and others were held in the form of mortgage-backed securities. Under accounting rules, these securities had to be marked to market, even if the underlying mortgages were still paying interest and principal when due. When the bubble started to deflate in 2007, investors fled the market for these securities, and this is what the market looked like. You can see the precipitous decline that occurred there. In effect, there was no market. The value of these securities plummeted, and with it, the capital level of banks and others as they had to write down their assets. Inevitably, these firms looked unstable and possibly insolvent. The SEC could have suspended mark-to-market accounting, but it did not. The turmoil in the market continued until 6 months after the crisis, the Financial Accounting Standards Board agreed to loosen the mark-to-market rules. At that point, the Dow was at about 6,600. Almost immediately thereafter, however, the stock market's recovery began to where it is today. How then did weak financial firms turn into a financial crisis? This is a classic story of moral hazard. Investors, creditors, and managers, relying on what they thought was a government policy, took or didn't take steps they would have taken under other circumstances. In March 2009, the government rescued Bear Stearns. This was an investment bank, not government insured. The Fed provided $29 billion in risk sharing to induce J.P. Morgan Chase to acquire Bear, which seemed headed for bankruptcy. At that point, market participants thought the government had established a policy that it would not allow large financial firms to fail. This idea changed everything. Managers no longer thought that they had to raise new equity to reassure their creditors. The creditors would now be protected by the government. Weak firms thought they could drive harder bargains when approached by stronger firms or others with strategic investment ideas. Creditors saw no need to recognize losses by selling the debt of firms that were weak, believing that the government would bail them out if the firm failed. But in September 2008, the government completely reversed itself and allowed Lehman Brothers to fail. Investors and creditors who thought they had understood the risks they were facing were completely upended. Now they wanted cash, and they wanted it immediately. No financial institution could survive at that point if a rumor got around that it could not meet every demand for cash. As a result, hoping to hold enough cash for all demands, banks refused to lend to each other, even overnight. This was unprecedented, but this was the financial crisis. Ironically, the Lehman bankruptcy showed that it had been a huge mistake to rescue Bear. No large financial institution got into trouble or failed because of the failure of Lehman, even though Lehman was 50% larger than Bear. The fear that Bear's interconnections with other firms would cause other firms to fail was shown to be imaginary. The moral hazard created by the rescue of Bear far outweighed whatever temporary peace it bought. As Lehman showed, if Bear had been allowed to fail, no other firm would have failed. But all, including Lehman, would have loaded up on equity. And then, if Lehman had eventually failed, the remaining firms would have been financially stronger and far better capitalized. There would have been no panic, and likely no financial crisis. That's all I have to say right now. I'm looking forward to the comments. Thanks very much.
Thank you, Peter. And may I ask the discussants to come up and join us in front, please? I wish you would. And while you all are coming, I'll just mention that the 1992 Act, which Peter discussed and of course analyzes a lot in the book, was ironically called the GSE Safety and Soundness Act of 1992. And we have a truly outstanding panel today, and let me introduce its members. Our first discussant, John Allison, is the president and CEO of the Cato Institute. Previously, he was chairman and CEO of BB&T Corporation from 1989 to 2008, during which time BB&T grew from $4.5 billion to $152 billion in assets, and John was named by the Harvard Business Review as one of the top 100 most successful CEOs in the world. He's also the author of The Financial Crisis and the Free Market Cure, Why Pure Capitalism is the World Economy's Only Hope, and of The Leadership Crisis and the Free Market Cure, Why the Future of Business Depends Upon the Return to Life, Liberty, and the Pursuit of Happiness. Next will be Mark Zandi, the Chief Economist of Moody's Analytics. Mark is a co-founder of Economy.com, which Moody's purchased about 10 years ago. Mark's research interests include macroeconomics, financial markets, and public policy, with recent research focused on mortgage finance reform and the determinants of mortgage foreclosure and personal bankruptcy. And he has assessed the appropriate policy responses to bubbles in asset markets. Mark frequently testifies before Congress and is the author of Paying the Price, Ending the Great Recession and Beginning a New American Century, and of Financial Shock, a 360-degree look at the subprime mortgage implosion and how to avoid the next financial crisis. Mark and I were just chatting before the conference on when we think the next financial crisis is due. Our third discussant will be Dan Gallagher, who has been commissioner of the U.S. Securities and Exchange Commission since 2011. Dan was on the staff of the SEC beginning in 2006 when he served as counsel to SEC Commissioner Paul Atkins and later to the chairman, Chris Cox. He subsequently joined the Division of Trading and Markets as deputy director and then acting director, where he played a key role in the SEC's response to the financial crisis, including credit rating agencies and credit default swaps. And has also been a partner of Wilmer Hale and general counsel and senior vice president of Fiserv Securities. Each of our panelists is going to speak from 12 to 15 minutes, after which we'll give Peter a chance to respond to their comments and then have some discussion among the speakers, and then we will open the floor to your questions. And John, we're delighted to have the leader of Cato here, and welcome to AEI.
Well, thank you and good afternoon. It's a pleasure to be here. I guess following Peter's comments, I'd just say amen. I really enjoyed reading Peter's book. It brought back memories. I was the longest serving CEO of a major financial institution in the United States, and I got to see the housing bubble develop and burst, and Peter did a fantastic job of describing it. I think this is an important book because of the story. The myth that deregulation caused a financial crisis has justified radical expansion and regulation in the United States in a very destructive manner. I thought Peter's particular focus was putting together a lot of facts. It's amazing how many people have written about the financial crisis without any facts, and particularly academics, interestingly enough, and I thought that was a huge contribution. It is very deep and very integrated view of the housing bubble. Chapter 14, I just thought he did a great job of summarizing what I think is very accurate. He talks about the false narrative in the future. The preceding chapters show that the government housing policies implemented principally through Freddie Mac and Fannie Mae reduced mortgage underwriting standards, built an unprecedented housing bubble, and in combination with mark-to-market accounting and blundering government response was the primary cause of the 2008 financial crisis. And then he goes on to say, well, it's going to happen again if we continue the direction we're headed in. In the next part of that chapter, he does something I think is incredibly important, and he mentioned this in his comments. There is a real myth about the interconnectedness in the financial system. At BB&T, we'd been doing business with Bear Stearns and Lehman Brothers and Goldman Sachs for, whatever, 80 years. If they had all failed, we'd have lost a little bit of money, but we really wouldn't have noticed the difference. We got much more damage from a bunch of small home builders failing out of the financial crisis than this perception that there was this interconnection, this and the whole system was going down. In fact, there were only about 8 or 10 financial firms in trouble out of the thousands in the U.S., including lots of large firms that weren't in trouble, like Wells Fargo and BB&T. And there's been a huge misconception that it was a systematic problem, when in fact it was a very focused problem. There was no liquidity problem. The liquidity was, there was an inflow of deposits to banks. BB&T was buried with cash. It was simply a flight to quality. And the people that were losing the money were the people that should have gone out of business. It was a total misconception of what was going on. And I think Peter really identifies that and the implications for the futures in a very effective way. So I would congratulate him on what I think is an excellent book that everyone should read. Now, I have one disagreement, and I don't think Peter's going to be surprised about this, and I'll have to admit it is a pretty material disagreement in that he really kind of dismisses the role of the Federal Reserve. I disagree. Having been through the early 80s and the early 90s, I think the Federal Reserve is the primary cause of all bubbles in the economy. I don't think you can have a bubble without the Federal Reserve, because where does the money come from, which would be my primary question. And particularly if you look at M3, which Alan Greenspan decided to quit reporting, but M3 actually reflects what's happening in the economic system. And the reason we can be pretty certain this is true, there were major bubbles in both the commodities market and in the stock market. And how could those have been caused by Freddie Mac and Fannie Mae? Now, housing bubbles are more destructive because they're long-term assets, they're owned by individuals, people think they're safe assets, and people are very surprised, and has huge kinds of psychological effects. But there were multiple bubbles in 2007, not just the housing bubble, and they all burst. The Fed creates a false sense of low risk, and this was a so-called Greenspan put, and I saw this in the whole business, not just in housing, but in all parts of the market. Every time the economy started correcting, Greenspan printed a whole bunch of money, and we all started feeling more comfortable. And that led to irrational risk-taking. In addition, it led to a lower savings rate. And one of the unfortunate things that blew the housing bubble up was people's perception that they didn't need to save money because their housing was going to keep appreciating and their houses were their savings. This is an esoteric point, but inflation, which the Fed reported is very low, in fact, in real terms, was very high. There are unusual periods of time, same thing happened in the 1920s, where extraordinary things are happening to economic productivity, and in a pure free market, in a gold kind of standard economy, prices would be falling. In the 1920s, you had electricity and automobiles and the radio, huge improvements in productivity. Prices would have been falling if you'd had a real gold standard in the 1920s, which we did not. In the late 1990s and the early 2000s, prices would have been falling because of the introduction of huge increases in productivity in China and India, where billions of people, for the first time, were being allowed to be productive. And we should have had a free fall in prices. So if you have stable prices, what's actually happened is you got a real artificial factor keeping prices stable. And that makes people think there's less risk. And that makes them overly consume, exactly the same thing happened in the 1920s. So the false perception of no price increases led to very high levels of consumption. Also, of course, low interest rates, which the Fed engineered, encourages people to buy bigger houses. You know, if the difference in your house payment between a 6% rate and a 3% rate could stay low forever because we had a savings glut. And so a lot of people took out adjustable rate mortgages and negative amortization mortgages. And then when the Fed decided to raise rates, they got a really bad surprise on what their house payments were. And the Fed did raise rates dramatically, which is other evidence that they knew they created a bubble, even though they deny it today. They increased interest rates 425% in 2 years. That's the most percentage increase ever. And the percentage increase makes a lot of difference. I use this with college students. I used to say to college students I was teaching at Wake Forest, what if your tuition went up 425% in 2 years? Would that impact your life? Well, that's exactly what happened with interest rate. A huge percentage increase that the financial markets had a hard time integrating, and in the process, they inverted the yield curve. Banks make money by borrowing short and lending long. If short-term rates are higher than long-term rates, banks are buying watermelons for $10 and selling them for $8. It's not much fun. And one of the interesting things you can do in the banking business, if you want to get higher prices, you can take more risk. The Fed is projecting, Bernanke's projecting, good times forever. We've had this long run in the economy without an economic correction. Why not take more risk? If you look at the housing bubble, it kind of goes exponential. You can look at Peter's charts. One of that was because of an incredible amount of optimism and no margins in the business. And of course, Peter talked about this. When they saved institutions like Bear, it created a lot of misinformation. The other thing about their regulatory role, remember, the Fed sets capital requirements for banks. And you could have half as much capital for a subprime loan as a loan to Exxon. What do? You make subprime loans, or at least a lot of people made subprime loans in that kind of environment. So lots of Fed background effort in terms of creating the housing bubble. And then it became so bad because of all the policies that Peter describes and all the government interference in the housing market. Despite my comments about the Fed, I do think this is a very important book. It can show how altruistic policies can create bad outcomes. When I think one reason that people like to accept the outcome being driven by greed on Wall Street, because that's what you hear at church and hear on TV, greed's a bad thing and altruism is a good thing. And so you're actually having a philosophical fight about this issue. My experience is there's always been maximum greed on Wall Street. There was no more greed than ever on Wall Street, and greed had nothing to do with the financial crisis. It was an altruistic policy of trying to raise home ownership that led to bad economic outcomes. So good intentions don't necessarily produce good results. I want to thank Peter for his research. I wrote a book, and I couldn't have done it without Peter's work on the housing crisis, the numbers he's put together. His efforts to get the story right was very, very important, because if you have the wrong cause, you are of necessity going to have the wrong cure, and that is exactly where we are, and we're getting ready to do it again. It's just a matter of time. We're doing exactly what Peter said caused the problem in the first place, and we're doing it again, and it's kind of eerie. So thank you, Peter, for a great book.
Thank you, John. Mark.
Thank you. Appreciate that. Just for sake of disclosure, I'm also on the board of MGIC and on the board of a nonprofit CDFI, the Reinvestment Fund, just so that everyone knows where I'm coming from. There's a lot in the book I agree with. I think most fundamentally, and I guess this is the key point going forward, I do think the government's role in the mortgage market is too large. It's not needed, and I think you can even use the word inappropriate. 80% of purchase mortgage loans being made today are being made by taxpayers, effectively, through Fannie Mae, Freddie Mac, the FHA, VA. If you add it all up, it's about 80%, and that doesn't make a whole lot of sense. Taxpayers don't need to shoulder that burden, and we need to figure out a way to change that picture. We need GSE reform desperately. This isn't a good way to run the nation's housing and mortgage markets. I think bottom line, that's sort of your point. You know, when it all comes out in the wash, you're saying that government's role is outsized here, and we need to change that. And I agree with that. I also agree with you know, specific aspects of your discussion and parts of the book. I particularly am sympathetic to your chapter on mark-to-market accounting. I think you called it fair value accounting. I think you're right that contributed to the illiquidity in the financial markets. It's hard to get a price, in part because of the effects of mark-to-market accounting, and I think we need to really think about that carefully. I can see both sides of that argument. There's good arguments on both sides of it, but I don't think we have this quite right, and I think that could be a problem in the next financial crisis. You know, you can, in fact, the liquidity in the financial system today is probably less than it was pre-crisis for a lot of the changes that have occurred, some of which are related to Dodd-Frank, and you can see large swings in equity and fixed income prices And a lot of that has to do with liquidity issues, and I think this is something that we need to address going forward. So I'm very sympathetic to that. I also agree that government played a role in the crisis. I actually think the most significant role it played was it botched the resolution of failing institutions. And you spent a fair amount of time on that in the context of Barron. You mentioned this. I'm not sure I entirely agree with your perspective on that, but I do agree that policymakers really didn't have a playbook for trying to resolve troubled institutions. And each institution that got into trouble was treated differently. Bear was treated differently from Fannie Freddie, was treated differently from Lehman, AIG, Wachovia, Wells, as you go down the list. And we got to a point where creditors in the financial system, you know, the bondholders, the equity holders, the guys that put up the capital, the people who put up the capital, didn't really know where they stood with respect to the government. And they panicked, and they just literally ran for the doors, and thus the crisis. So lesson for me from that is that we need to have a better resolution process. And in fact, of all the things that have come out of Dodd-Frank, and there are many things, some of which I like, some of which I don't like. The thing I like the most is the attempt to put forward a resolution process so that if we get into another financial crisis that we have something of a cookbook. Unfortunately, we won't know if the cookbook works until we actually get into a crisis, but at least we have a framework for addressing institutions that get trouble. So that's what I agree with. This is what I don't agree with. And it's the fundamental premise of your book. I don't agree with it. And that is that Fannie Mae and Freddie Mac's affordable housing goals are the principal cause for the financial crisis. I don't agree. Maybe if I had to list the top 10 things, it might make it onto the list, but I'm not even sure it would. It might be number 10. It might not even make it on the list. I think to explain the financial crisis, you have to explain a number of facts, and you take a crack at it, but there are three key facts that need to be explained very, very clearly, particularly in the context of your premise that the affordable housing goals were at the root of the crisis. One is that Fannie Mae and Freddie Mac's share of the mortgage market declined precipitously between 2003 and 2006. And that's the period, in my view, when the bubble was inflating. That if you look at Federal Reserve flow of funds data, now financial accounts data, the share of debt that Fannie and Freddie backed, mortgage debt, you know, single-family residential mortgage debt that Fannie and Freddie backed, peaked at 43%. And I know these numbers because I looked at them. I can even tell you to the second decimal point, but I'll round. 43% second half of 2003, it fell and hit bottom in the second half of 2006 at 35%. And by the way, 35% was the share of the mortgage market that Fannie and Freddie backed in 1993, when the affordable housing goals were first being implemented. And it was really the bubble in the housing market, and can you actually see it in the chart you showed, inflated in 2004, 2005, and in 2006. And that was a period when Fannie Mae and Freddie Mac were exiting the mortgage market. They were being pushed out of the mortgage market. It was really I believe in Occam's law that the most straightforward explanation is the right one, and if you just look at the share of mortgage debt that was backed by private RMBS, rose in tandem with the decline in the share that was backed by Fannie Mae and Freddie Mac. And by the way, I am an employee of the Moody's organization. I didn't cause any of this. I had nothing to do with it. I sold my company to them at the peak, so I had nothing to do with it. But I am Wall Street in front of you right here. I am the fixed income market. The second fact is, and again, you take a crack at it, but I think not convincingly. There were housing bubbles in other parts of the world, in the UK, in Ireland, Spain. If you talk to the Canadians, they'll debate you whether they have a bubble, but, you know, feels like a bubble slightly. Australia. And if Fannie and Freddie's affordable housing goals were at the root of the problem, then, you know, why these bubbles forming overseas? Now, you make a good point that those bubbles didn't crater crash and take out the economy in lots of those other economies, but it did in the UK, Ireland, and Spain, and that those are the same markets where we had a thriving private label securities market. It didn't take mortgage market out, the economy out in Canada and Australia, because those are systems that are dominated by four or five very large banking institutions. They make all the loans, they hold all the credit risk, they are highly regulated institutions. There is no private label securities market to speak of in those markets. So that's a second fact that needs to be explained. The third is, if you look at the realized losses on residential mortgages from 2006 to 2013, I don't have full year data for 2014, so let's look at 06, 2013, and look at realized losses, so get around the mark-to-market accounting issues, relative to debt outstanding. You'll see that the total losses, realized losses over that period, were 9-10%. So 1 in 10 dollars of mortgage debt outstanding that were originated in the bubble essentially got written off by the system, the financial system. And obviously, that's a lot of money, about $1 trillion worth, and you have to write off $1 trillion. That goes a long way to explaining why the system choked on it. And then you look at it, the losses, the realized losses by who held the credit risk. Well, depository institutions, the banks, had a 6% realized loss. Fannie Mae and Freddie Mac had a 3% realized loss, 3%. If you throw in the MIs, the PMIs, you're getting up to 4%, maybe 4.5%. Private label securities have had a realized loss, and this is hard data, because I have the data. You know, this is pools of securities. I have it, security by security, is 23%. So, you know, you can do the forensic accounting, and Ed does a really nice job of that and deserves a lot of credit. But at the end of the day, what really matters is losses. You know, where are the losses? And they're not in Fannie Mae and Freddie Mac. So that needs to be explained. So let me end by saying, in my view, there are many reasons for the crisis. And I think you really could literally put a list together, a top 10 list. There's that many causes. There are lots of blame to go around. Again, none of it my fault, but, you know, lots of blame to go around. But I'd put three things at the top of the list. One is a surfeit of global saving. You know, China, emerging economies were coming onto the scene after China entered into the WTO in 2000. Huge current account surpluses. That money had to be reinvested. And that goes to explaining why you had and I sympathize to some degree with what you're saying about the Fed, but you also had tremendous capital flows going into all parts of the fixed income market, equity market. That's why junk corporate spreads got the 250 basis points, why spreads in every asset category got compressed. And that global surface of global savings is the fodder for the egregious mortgage lending. The second is the private label securities market was fundamentally broken at the core. From the originator to the investment bank that issued the securities, to the rating agencies that rated the securities, and we can talk about every aspect of this and we can in detail with regard to how it was broken, to the investors themselves. The system, no one had a clear understanding of how the private label securities market system worked from A to Z, and it was fundamentally broken. So we took this surfeit of global saving, we pumped it through the securitization machine, and we got a mess because it was literally broken. And finally, thirdly, in my view, it's a regulatory failure on lots of levels. I mean, if you look at the originators who were most egregious and messed things up, they were not regulated at the federal level. Most of them were very lightly regulated at the state level. Ameriquest, New Century Financial, even Countrywide. And the regulatory thinking at the time was we should not address these problems from a macroprudential perspective. Now, that has changed, and Dodd-Frank, you know, embodies that. And I know a lot of work Alex has been doing is in this regard with the use of LTVs and restricting LTVs. And it's used in other countries now in terms of macroprudential policy. But that was not part of the thinking. And to some degree, the rating agencies themselves were outsourced regulators. You know that they were required to regulate, and they didn't. They failed. So if I had to list the top three things, those are the three things. And those three things, if you think about it, explain my three facts, I think, better in a more consistent and coherent way. And I think at the end of the day, again, I don't think the affordable housing goals, they might make it on the list, but it would be at the very bottom of the list. Thank you.
And thank you, Mark.
I should say one other thing. I know Peter knew I was going to say this, and that's why I'm here. I am the foil. Yeah.
And we're delighted to have you here.
Yeah.
Before we go on to Dan, I just want to put in a thought, which is one of the fascinating things about financial cycles is that the lessons of the previous cycle feed forward into the next cycle and may be the problems that you then have next time. For example, it's sobering to think that the American housing finance system collapsed twice in 20 years, first in the 1980s and then in the 2000s. And one of the big lessons drawn especially by academics but also by many others from the 80s collapse was that you had to have mark-to-market accounting and that would save you. And in fact, when we got into the crisis, mark-to-market accounting helped create the panic. Now, Mark is right, in the long run, it's losses that matter, but in the short run of the panic, perceptions
matter.
Anyway, Saul, it's a great discussion, and Dan, we'll go on to you.
Well, first of all, it's a real honor to be here. Peter, thanks for inviting me. I guess I bring the perspective, one of the perspectives I bring is the Dodd-Frank end user, which for those of you who don't know is a bad Dodd-Frank pun from Title VII of Dodd-Frank, the derivatives provision. Alex knew. As you know, with most government officials, I got to start by giving the standard disclaimer that my views are my own and don't necessarily reflect those of the commission or the other commissioners. And if you had any doubt about that, I'm fresh off three no votes today on a Dodd-Frank rules involving derivatives. It's pretty obvious I don't speak for the commission, but I do speak. And I would like to speak about this book. I think this book does a tremendous public service for us all, as Peter has done actually in the government, wonderful amounts of public service, even now, and I assume you'd like to make some money off this book, Peter, that's great, but you're doing a public service in addition to all the hard work you put in. This book will make people think, and that's actually my favorite part. I did get further than just the inside of the cover, but my favorite sentence from the whole book is on the inside cover. After this book is published, no one will be able to claim that the financial crisis was caused by insufficient regulation or defend Dodd-Frank without coming to terms with the data the book contains. And that, we've already seen, is what's going to happen. The data will speak. The debates will happen about the data. There are other books I like about the financial crisis. I love All the Devils Are Here. I like Reckless Endangerment. I like these journalist-driven, balanced books, but they're not as full of data as Peter's book. And for a Dodd-Frank end user, I can tell you I'm going to be an end user of this book too, as we continue to make policy based on Dodd-Frank at the commission. And that is hugely important because there's another side of Dodd-Frank that people forget, and I can't because I live it every day. I did it through three no votes today. Dodd-Frank will continue to live in the regulatory world, in the SEC in particular, for at least a decade to come. And let's get back to data. 2,319 pages of Dodd-Frank, 400, I'm using round numbers, 400 rulemaking mandates to the regulators, 100 went to the SEC. I like to call it the booby prize. And what folks don't get is, even though it's half a decade ago, Dodd-Frank will be this July, we are not yet half done our rulemakings at the SEC. It dominates the agenda of the SEC. I just gave a speech in October at an LA Bar Conference. Boy, were they not prepared for my remarks there. The sleepy little CLE event, but talking about the agenda and how it's dominated by congressional mandates, in particular Dodd-Frank. And today is just such a it's an amazing day to be here after coming off these votes today, where Title VII of Dodd-Frank, which is geared towards derivatives, is geared towards the narrative of derivatives in the crisis that, quite frankly, derivatives caused the financial crisis. This is one of the problems in construct of Dodd-Frank, is that each title, I submit to you, solves one narrative of the financial crisis in its own way without reference necessarily to the other. So if you believe, unlike me, that derivatives caused the financial crisis, we did God's work today. We put three of about 30 rules that we need to do under Title VII to rest, and we will someday catch up to the CFTC, who owns 95% of this market and finished their rules 14 months ago. One of the other wonderful aspects of Dodd-Frank is that it sought, of course, to rationalize the so-called alphabet soup of regulators in Washington. So they got rid of OTS and created three other agencies, which is terrific. And you know, at the SEC, if there was ever going to be a moment to merge the SEC and CFTC, it was after the crisis. It didn't happen. So I'm not sanguine going forward that we're going to get the regulatory rationalization that we need. So tying this back into the book, I think the a few things stick out to me as an SEC commissioner. One, I think the chapter on the FCIC process, who better to write it, I think it's critically important. I lived, and Alex alluded to this, but I lived the crisis literally on the 30th floor of Lehman Brothers the week of September 15th. I lived the crisis at the New York Fed that weekend too. I saw how decisions were made and the irrational things that happened. And I, for one, was horrified at what I saw. And I won't go down that rabbit hole too long, but we all thought and knew and expected that Congress would respond to this crisis. That's what Congress can and should do. But I, for one, thought it would be after deliberative process, much study. When I give a little stump speech on the SEC to folks, I like to talk about 1929, the period 1929 to 1934. 1934, of course, is the year that the Securities and Exchange Act was created, enacted. That statute created the SEC. It was a five-year period, if my math is right. I was never good at math. What happened in that five-year period? Well, there's two presidents, so there's some handoff issues and the like, but you get a process in that five-year period in which, of all things, they grab a Manhattan DA to come down and run public hearings and create a body of evidence that led to the creation of the federal securities laws and other laws related to the New Deal. And those laws were incredibly incremental. If you go back and you look at the 1933 Act, which is the first federal securities law that came in the New Deal, I believe it's only 30 or 40 pages long, but it was the first federal intrusion into corporate disclosure and registration of securities. It was massively transformational, but brief, and it derived from the work that had been done by the DA and others to study the cause of the 1929 crash. The 34 Act, the same thing. They built upon a body of work, and you can agree or disagree with it. One thing I don't disagree with the investigation is that it was deliberative, that there is evidence that was put up to support legislation. And so in 2008, as I sat in the smoldering ruins of Lehman Brothers, I thought someone's going to figure this out and we might get a good policy response here. I was thrilled to hear about the creation of the Financial Crisis Inquiry Commission. I was saddened to see not only its composition and corporate structure, but that its report, of course, would post-date Dodd-Frank by 7 months. That's not how it worked in the 20s when we were even doing things back then that were incremental. Dodd-Frank is not incremental, I will submit to you, not only in length and breadth. It is incredibly massive, and there was no process sanctioned by the government to inform it. And I find that, as a citizen, very problematic. And so rehashing the lack of basis, the lack of introspection, the faults of the FCIC, I think, is incredibly important. So that just strikes out to me. As someone who every day has to look at rule mandates that come from a statute that I personally believe is based on false narratives, reading things like Peter's book, the description of the FCIC, the FCIC report itself, you know, besides Peter's dissent and Doug Holtzkin's dissent, is not for me, good guidance as a policymaker who's trying to make good policy. The chapter dealing with Lehman, as you might imagine, was particularly interesting for me. And I think Peter gets right to the heart of it. I was happy to see that he cited the New York Times article from last fall, the James Stewart, Peter Eavis piece that I thought was just fascinating, because when I read that, it was an A1 story in the New York Times. I'm not a big New York Times reader, but someone showed it to me. And boy, did it capture what I felt that weekend at Lehman Brothers. We did not know why they were not bailing out Lehman Brothers. Not that to take a position on the bailout or not, but given, as Peter points out, what happened with Bear Stearns, there wasn't this moral hazard only with respect to the investment banks and investors and others. There was moral hazard for regulators. We fully expected, based on precedent, that Lehman would be bailed out, that this game with the FSA was a game of chicken, and in the end, you would get a Bear Stearns-like result. I can tell you the feeling of shock at 4 or so in the afternoon on that Sunday when we found out we had to prepare for the bankruptcy that night. Quite a shock. And so this notion that there was no legal authority to do it always rang hollow with me. I never had time to reflect on it because, of course, for the next 90 days, I didn't sleep. But it never made sense to me, and Peter, I think, runs it to ground in a convincing fashion, and I commend that section to all of you, because I think it's incredibly important. I think so many of these myths and narratives about the crisis, as Peter points out in the book, it's not just the kind of thing you can say, well, we got this fact wrong, let's move on next time. Dodd-Frank made legislation around that little myth. And there are many other pieces of the legislation that were made around different pieces of the myth, whether they're discrete issues, like creating a resolution authority because you thought you didn't have the legal authority to bail out Lehman, or whether it's a narrative like the one that has always bothered me, for obvious reasons, that the SEC failed so tremendously in the crisis that it, in this sort of lottery of regulatory power that happened with Dodd-Frank, should lose, right? The narrative of failure of the SEC, of which there were some, don't get me wrong, I'm not a knee-jerk defender of the agency in the crisis. It's a small subcomponent of the narrative that regulatory failure caused the crisis. But at the SEC in particular, if you think about it, for me, and I've spoken publicly about this a lot, the notion that we failed with the CSE program, which Peter covers and dispels the myth about the capital rule, the notion that we failed with the reserve fund, the notion that we failed with the rating agencies, which is probably the truest one of all. These all feed into a narrative of an agency that's inept. And if anyone had any doubt, of course, for us in December of 2008, Mr. Madoff came along to prove it out. And then we get into the debate about Dodd-Frank. We enter as a weak agency. We're not an equal co-partner in the regulatory debates. And boy, do the Dodd-Frank mandates that run from that narrative really hurt. Where the Fed has a 165 rulemaking authority to enforce foreign banks to create an intermediate holding company, the SEC got a mandate to require the use of conflict minerals from the Congo for all public companies. And if Peter, if we're supposed to have a qualm with your book, if that's what this is all about, you've just glossed over the conflict minerals rulemaking. You glossed over the fact that it is the true cause of the financial crisis, and you glossed over that our rulemaking has ended that, and so we need not worry about the next one. So in the next version, I'll expect a chapter on tantalum and its role at Lehman Brothers. So I think in sum, I'll try to sum up. It's always hard for me. This book got me pretty passionate. This is going to be a hugely useful tool. It's a thought exercise. It's a debate point. It's data-centric, not beach reading, I don't think. Depends on what beach you were on. I feel pretty nerdy sometimes. But you know, having voted against 1,000 pages of rules today, Peter, I appreciated the homework assignment with another 300. But boy, qualitatively much more fun. I hope and expect that this book will get policymakers in Congress, elsewhere, will get folks like John and his group and others will be fodder for continued debate. Just for one last point, I think, and I said this earlier, but we can't say, well, maybe Peter's right, we got this one wrong, we'll get him next time. You can't. We can't. I can't. I won't. We cannot say that Dodd-Frank got it right, because if you do, you fail to see that we're not responding not only to the last crisis, but this notion that we're responding to the next one, I think, is complete myth and folly. So I appreciate what you've done for the country with this book, Peter. I look forward to using it for my own purposes. The SEC, of course, plays a limited role in the housing markets. To the extent this is focused on housing, I think we're out of the business with Fannie and Freddie these days, given that they're owned by all of us and not public investors. But anyway, I do think it will help us, and your work today at AEI has helped me in particular with, as you know, our qualified residential mortgage definition, which is, I think, proves out your whole theory, just that one rulemaking. And thanks for what you do.
Thank you, Dan. And we're going to give Peter a chance to respond to the various comments and to give him a further chance to organize his thoughts. And I want to stick in a couple of comments with respect to what Dan said. And one has to do with the 1929-1933 period. That was also the period of the creation of the Reconstruction Finance Corporation, which was the TARP of its day. But, John, I don't think the Reconstruction Finance Corporation ever forced any bank to take an investment that it didn't want. That was an innovation of the last crisis. The second point is, before I say something about the CFTC, I have to disclose that I'm a director of the CME Group, the biggest and greatest futures exchange. But, Dan, merging the SEC and the CFTC will not take place until the Banking Committee and the Agriculture Committee is merged in the Congress. With that, let me give Peter a chance to respond.
This is it. Okay. Thank you, Alex. Well, thank you all for your comments. They were terrific and helpful and educational for me, and I hope for the audience too. I won't respond to Dan's stuff because he covered it so well that I don't have anything really to say, but I do want to talk about something that John said, and then I will spend, if I have the time, Alex, maybe several minutes, 10 maybe, on what my friend Marco said. All right. Well, until you gavel me down, pen me down. In any event, John and I have had this talk many times, and I've actually had this talk with a number of other people, and that is the role of the Fed
in, including me,
the bubble. Yes, including you, including you. But I have always made one point, and I put this back on the unfortunately, I don't have the right chart up for this meeting, but in the book, there is a chart that has vertical lines that give you a sense of where the bubble was when the Fed was doing certain things. And when the Fed actually began, first of all, in 2001 and 2002, I should go back. In the year 2000, when the Fed had not lowered interest rates at all because we were in the midst of a boom, the bubble was already larger. You could see this in that chart that's in the book. It was already larger than any bubble we had ever had, at least post-war. It's already bigger than that. So the Fed couldn't actually be blamed for that. By 2003, when arguably the Fed had begun to reduce interest rates, although John Taylor says that it was only after 2003 that interest rates were reduced so that they were less than zero in inflationary terms. But if we look at 2003, the bubble was already three times the size of any bubble we had ever had before. So that had led me to believe and think that this bubble was not the result of inflation. You'll have to read the section in the book that talks about it. I think it's in chapter 2, but that's a position that we disagree on, John, and I think there's more to it. Now let me turn to Mark. Mark, that was excellent presentation, Mark, and I appreciate you taking the time to read the book. You think that the affordable housing goals were not responsible for this, and I want to question some of the data that you were using. You talked about the share of market that was responsible, that Fannie and Freddie were responsible for between 2002, I think, and 2006. And you said that they had their share of the market had declined substantially. And one of the reasons for that, of course, is that the private sector had increased substantially. Well, the reason, the way this happened, of course, was that Fannie and Freddie were selling to the private sector. The private sector was selling to Fannie and Freddie at that time. The way that the system was working was Fannie and Freddie were very eager to have these eligible loans under the affordable housing requirements, and the private sector was assembling them. And in some years, Fannie and Freddie bought 40% of all of the loans that the private sector was buying and selling. They were creating pools of mortgages, all of which were eligible for the affordable housing requirements. And because of that, it looked as though the private sector was doing a lot more than Fannie and Freddie were doing. But in fact, the private sector was simply selling to Fannie and Freddie during those years. And that's why the Fannie and Freddie's share looked less in terms of what they were putting out. The private sector looked more. But if you allocate the mortgages that the private sector was selling to Freddie and Fannie to Fannie and Freddie, they actually had a larger market share than the private sector did during those years. It's all in the book, and I urge you to read it. Another thing you said was that, I know you read it, but I urge everyone else to read it. The other thing you said was that there were housing bubbles in other parts of the world, and that is a significant point. But then you pointed out that the losses in the United States were much greater than they were anywhere else. And the work that was done by Dwight Jaffe, and there's a table of Dwight's work. Dwight Jaffe is a very well-known economist on housing at Berkeley. And he did some work on this, looking at the European sales and looking at the European losses. And his conclusions, which are in the book, show that in the greatest amount of loss occurred in England with about a 3% loss, 3.4%, if I recall correctly, on the mortgages that failed in the English economy. In the United States, the losses were 5 or 6 times that at Fannie and Freddie alone. They were somewhere between 13 to 17% losses in the portfolios that they held. And for the private sector, they were more than that. You mentioned, what I want to say about that is that if the losses were so much greater in the United States than they were anywhere else, what was the reason? And the reason, of course, was that in the United States, we had many, many more subprime and otherwise low-quality mortgages in our financial system that they did not have in any other country. And that includes Ireland, and includes the UK, and includes Spain. They all had big bubbles. They all had a collapse of the bubbles. It was bad for their economies. But the losses on the mortgages were much, much smaller than they were in the United States. Again, it's covered pretty fully in the book. Then, Mark, you talked about, and here's, I may have lost this number somewhere, but I think you said Fannie and Freddie's losses were 3%. Did you say that? Realized losses were 3%. All right, I don't know how that can work. What we know is that the government actually provided about $185, $186 billion to Fannie and Freddie after they failed in order to keep them solvent. And before they failed, they had about $100 billion in capital. Fannie had about 60, Freddie had about 40. So really the total loss was something like $280 billion. Well, they were realized losses in the sense that
they weren't ever realized.
Sorry. Those are that's the distinction between realized losses and unrealized. They were insolvent on a mark-to-market basis. That's what the capital hole was, right? Based on the mark-to-market account.
No, because as I said, in their 2008 financial report, their credit report, they showed actual losses, these were not mark-to-market losses, these were actual losses of 81% from these mortgages. And that's why the government had to reimburse them for all of these losses. Now, this is not a 3% loss. This was in the case of, if there were $280 billion in total losses, including the capital and then the amount that they lost after that, and the government had to reimburse, even if we take just the amount that the government had to reimburse between 2008 and 2012, if we just took that amount, that's $185 billion, of which maybe 60% was probably Fannie and about 40% was Freddie. That's still not 3% of realized losses, but those were actually realized losses because they occurred after the financial crisis and occurred, they were beginning, these were the evictions and defaults that were the cause of the losses that Fannie and Freddie were realizing. It wasn't as great as people anticipated, but it wasn't 3%. It was much, much larger than that. Now, Fannie and Freddie actually had much better subprime and other risky mortgages than the private sector had. And the reason for that, of course, was that they were able to buy the best of the worst because their cost of funds was much less than anyone else's. And so they could bid more for the mortgages that they really needed, and they left the private sector to pick up what was left.
One note on that, Freddie and Fannie pushed back a tremendous amount of losses into the private banking system. Stuff they were asking for at one point, and they said the banks hadn't properly documented. They pushed back hundreds of millions of dollars of loans back into the private banking system. You can only do that if you're the government and you got regulators that'll put the bank in jail if you don't take the losses.
You got
back.
It.
And they'd never won in court.
You got it. I mean, that is another factor, and so there were many losses that were suffered later by the private sector because they had to take back these mortgages.
Peter, no, I think you ought to take two more minutes
comments. So I think that the number is wrong. I think the actual realized losses were at least $185 billion and maybe more. But that's something we'll have to address
I'll
together.
Share it with you.
Yeah, and I'd like to see those. Then the question is, what effect did the losses that occurred actually have on the financial system? And the important thing to recall about Fannie and Freddie is that they had the largest number of mortgages that failed. And that is the point I was trying to make in my opening remarks, and that is that when mortgages fail, it's not the size of the mortgage that counts. It is the number of mortgages, because each mortgage that fails drives down housing prices in the area where, in the neighborhood where it occurs. And so it was Fannie and Freddie's enormous coverage of the United States and the fact that their mortgages were smaller than others. They were limited, they were much smaller than some of the private mortgages, but the fact that there were so many of them, which when they failed, drove down housing values all over the country 30% to 40%. So we have a little disagreement on the facts. I'd love to see what you're relying on, but I find it very difficult to imagine it was only 3%. And we have so much other data that shows that the losses that Fannie and Freddie suffered were the result of failures all over the country that drove down housing prices.
Thank you, Peter. Now we're going to give each of the discussants a chance to clarify or reply or make other points. If you want, I'd like to ask you to limit your next round of comments to 3 minutes maximum each, and I will remind you if you get to 3 minutes, and we'll just go down the panel. We talked a lot about private subprime mortgages. It hasn't come up that Fannie and Freddie were themselves the biggest, or at least certainly one of the biggest, buyers of subprime mortgages themselves. and were major supporters of that market. John.
Just to amplify a couple of Peter's points, I think it's a mistake not to understand the psychological impact of the government regulatory process making banks get into a business originally they didn't want to be in, making subprime loans, because banks are lending other people's money. So starting with the CRA Act, but also pressure from a regulatory perspective to meet production goals, and the easiest thing to do was sell them to Freddie and Fannie to meet the goals. And that had a huge impact, that you were doing something that you, quote, could make a profit, but also that you needed to do from a regulatory perspective. And then back to the Federal Reserve point, Peter and I will argue this forever, but I don't think you could have, it's easy to focus on the housing bubble because it was so visible and it was the most destructive bubble, but there was a huge bubble in commodities and a big bubble in the stock market. Is it not independent of these other bubbles? And the Fed is the only one that could have caused the collective bubbles. It's just math, just numbers. And also, since we had the world's reserve currency, we sponsored bubbles all over the world. We drove the housing markets in lots of the rest of the world. Because when you have the reserve currency, it's exactly what we've done to Brazil in the commodities market. When you have the world's reserve currency, you create bubbles in other places.
My friend Brendan Brown wrote a book called The Global Curse of the Federal Reserve, in which he makes that argument. Mark, your turn again.
Well, I think it's very encouraging that we're here debating data. Great. So I'll share with you, and we'll have a debate and discussion, and I feel pretty convicted in my numbers, but you do as well, and that's wonderful that this is the level of debate that we're having. That's all I want to say. I failed to say, though, and I should have ended this way, you are an incredible thought leader. You are amazingly prolific, although I give all the credit to Frida for that. I don't know how you do it, but you really put out incredibly high quality work on a consistent basis, and you do it with grace. So I don't agree with many things you do say, but I do admire the way you say them. And I just want to end that way.
Thank you, Mark. Dan, further comments?
So we could have called this panel, we should have titled it Lies, Damn Lies, and Statistics, Peter. That's the way it's going. Well, you said I got it all right in the first go-round, so I'll cede back my time.
Thank you. That will be popular with the audience. Now, ladies and gentlemen, the time has come for your turn. Please let me remind you of AEI rules. When I call on you, wait for the microphone, so that you will be recorded for all posterity. Tell us your name and your affiliation. We'll start up here. Brian, if you want to. Yes, thanks. Bring the microphone's right there, right there. And then we'll get the questions I saw back up this way.
I guess because the Gene Epstein, economics columnist at Barron's, three questions that are mainly addressed to Mark, who's raising the most interesting controversies here. The global savings glut, I've heard that from Bernanke and from Greenspan. Somehow they never noticed there was some kind of glut when they were serving on the Federal Reserve Board, when they were talking about it. They were cheering the housing market. And I never noticed from any of the transcripts they noticed this. And then, of course, it was John Taylor who was the first to point out that the global savings rate was declining. The domestically, U.S. savings was going to the toilet, and you'd think that would be the most crucial thing. So for you to put, first question is, why do you put the global savings, or the savings from China, is so important? You forget savings is collapsing in the U.S. Globally, in terms of the proper measure, global savings is declining, as John Taylor pointed out. So I would say this is just an excuse that Bernanke and Greenspan are resorting to, and you're repeating it. You don't have any stake in it. You don't have any horse in that, Mark. So that's the first question. So the second question is, do you place some kind of weight on the more intangible, aside from the data issue? The data issue, which you skirted, which is like 3/4 of the toxic mortgages are accounted for, not just by Fannie and Freddie, but by FHA and so on. So that's a number that's important. But then the moral suasion, the jawboning, all of the rhetoric that was put out about Fannie and Freddie have got to set the new standard. Clinton's talking about it. Bush is talking about it. Doesn't that have some effect on the private sector's behavior? And yet you say it doesn't even make the top 10? Don't banksters respond to that in some way? And Fannie is putting out money and buying it? So those are my two points about why is global savings so high up there when global savings was declining? And second, why is affordable housing goals so unimportant when it's coming from the White House, both from the Republicans, from the Democrats, when it's coming from Barney Frank, when it's coming from so many sources, and you say, it doesn't matter, private sector was not responding, and Fannie and Freddie are buying it big time, and yet doesn't matter. It's not even, doesn't make your top 10. Why is that? No, those are my only two.
Okay, thanks. And you got two questions. I think those are both directed to Mark. Anybody else is going to be free to comment as well.
Well, good points, Gene. I think Bernanke actually talked at length while he was at the Federal Reserve on the global savings glut. In fact, I think the speech was global savings glut, I believe. And the question was why he was trying to explain why long-term interest rates were so low at the time and why credit spreads were so narrow. And so I think he was very, even as chairman of the Federal Reserve, this was key to his thinking.
We're going to let Mark go ahead and answer.
Yeah, the key is
we can debate this in the reception.
Yeah, the key is in fact the current account, the current account deficit. It ballooned between the late 90s, 2000, and at the peak of the bubble. At the peak of the bubble, the current account deficit was 6-7% of GDP. Just for context, it's about 2.5% of GDP. This coincided with the China coming onto the scene, lifting commodity prices and lifting all EM economies that ran huge current account surpluses. They had dollars to invest. Those dollars had to come back into the United States and had to be invested somewhere. Initially, they were treasuries, thus the low treasury yield. And then ultimately, as they went out on the risk profile, we saw credit spreads come in, and they were big buyers of Fannie Freddie securities and ultimately MBS and all kinds of things. And of course, as that money came in, it did drive other investors into taking further risks out on the credit spectrum, into CDOs and other things to gain yield. So I do think the global savings glut is real, and I think there's a lot of evidence, and I think that was a key point. And I agree with you, the Federal Reserve played a role in this and could have weighed against that, but failed to do so, and I think that would be in my top five. In fact, in my book, I devote a chapter to that issue. So I concur with you. I'm sorry, Peter, but I concur. You actually make a very good, Gene, to your second point about suasion. I agree with that. I do think we wanted to be the ownership society. That was the Bush word, but you know, homeownership was key to this, and this began in the Clinton administration. And there was a lot of effort to promote homeownership, and the homeownership did rise between 1994 and 2004. It rose quite significantly, and I do think that played a role. I just don't think it was the affordable housing goals that were key to that. Now, maybe you can use that as a symbolic measure of all of those things. Yes, maybe. I'm not so sure, but I don't think it's the affordable housing goals that are the key element of the point you're trying to make. I agree with the point. It would be in my top 10 list, maybe in the top five. It just wouldn't be the affordable housing goals.
I'm told that the original note from the Clinton administration mortgage task force, which promoted what they called innovative credit, which meant lower credit, of course, that those notes have been removed from the Department of Housing website, and you can't find them anymore. I don't know if that's true, but I've been told that. One other just thing, speaking of China and global savings, in Henry Paulson's book on the crisis, which is, I think, a very useful read, he tells about how after they've bailed out Fannie and Freddie, and he goes to China for the Olympics, and he meets his friend, the finance minister of China. And they're talking about Fannie and Freddie, and Paulson says, "I told you we'd take care of you." back here, please. Yes, well, I'm just going to go this way, right here.
Yeah, hi, I'm Jim Vitarello. I'm a housing specialist for GAO. So I have a question for Mr. Zandi and also a I guess a question for Peter, also a sort of a statement concerning John Weicker. But first, let me start with Mr. Zandi. You provided, and I'm a little deaf, so I may not have gotten it, but I thought I only heard you talk about percentage of realized losses, not actual dollar losses. Is that correct? In your presentation?
Yeah, I articulated actual realized losses.
As a percent. We'll take your question
as a percent of debt outstanding.
We'll take the question, Mark, right. What were the dollars? Do we know?
Well,
yeah. Yeah, there were, roughly speaking, there were $11 trillion in residential mortgage debt outstanding, including home equity lines of credit. And by the way, this is as of Q4 2007. The numbers wouldn't change if you picked another quarter, but I picked that. And realized actual losses Fannie Mae, Freddie Mac, between 06-07 to 2013, I haven't included 14 data, is roughly 3%. Now, but if you throw in the private MI companies.
But how many dollars is that?
No, dollars.
Well, the total losses were 9 to 10%, so about $1 trillion in realized losses. And of that, I don't know. I can't remember offhand. I can send you the table.
No, I mean for the GSEs. What? In other words, can we have a sort of apples-to-apples comparison? Because when you use percentages, it's really not, in my opinion, an apples-to-apples comparison because the size of the GSE portfolio is so much higher than what the PLS market was. You really can't compare the two.
Yeah, good
all right,
point.
So dollars for dollar, particularly in that critical period 06, 07, and 08 when Fannie was declared, you know, Fannie and Freddie were declared bankrupt, right?
Okay. So let me do this. Okay. So this is called a back-of-the-envelope calculation, and I will share with everyone the data. Say Fannie Mae and Freddie Mac were 40% of the market. So let's say 40% of $11 trillion is $4.5 trillion. Take 3% of that. That's your number. So that would be what? That would be $225 billion, something like that, right? Yeah, $225 billion out of a trillion in total losses. Right. Take the private label securities market.
Against capital of 100.
It's even less than that, right? Because that includes deferred tax assets. You throw those out and you basically got zero, which is another reason why they had to take $185 billion because they had no capital going into this. I mean, no, they had capital on the books. It was all DTA. You take rid of that, I got zero capital. So the problem is they had no capital going into it. I couldn't even take, 1% of losses, right? Mm. All right, because
very good
solved.
Point. Okay, now we're going to let you ask your next
well,
question, and then we're going to go on.
I didn't hear what the actual dollar amount of the PLS market, what the realized losses were.
Okay, so the PLS loss rate, and again, this is a back of the envelope calculation,
right.
Was 23%. And at the end of 07, they had about $1 trillion in debt outstanding, probably 1.2, 1.3 trillion.
All right.
So, $250 billion. So even a little bit higher than Fannie Mae and Freddie Mac in terms of losses.
Yeah. So they were. And by the way, one last quick question: Did the GSE losses? Did that include the purchase of the MBS that Peter talks about too?
Sure, absolutely.
Include that too.
Yeah. Now, Now, John made an excellent point. It also includes the money earned in buyback, right?
It's reduced by the buyback.
Yeah, now we can debate whether that's good or bad or wrong or right, but that's part of the calculation, right? Yeah.
Very good. Okay, let's go on to next question. Thank you very much. Good questions.
Bert Ely, a banking consultant here in D.C. I got a softball question for Peter.
I hope it turns out to be that. Go ahead.
I know that you and I and many others are long-time advocates of getting rid of Fannie and Freddie and basically getting government out of the housing finance business. But Dodd-Frank, of course, went way beyond that. I'm interested in hearing more than what's in the book in terms of the specific reforms that you would propose, not just directly in the housing finance field, but given that housing finance is part of financial intermediation overall, what should be the reform agenda over the next 5 years? What should be the three top reforms that Congress, that you would like to see Congress enact?
Boy, is that a softball question?
What's a hardball question? You don't want me asking that. Well, you're talking about housing area, or you're talking about in general? In finance, including government. Go ahead.
In general, because I think it's important to recognize that housing finance is not isolated from the rest of the financial system.
Right.
It is a key element of financial intermediation, and therefore it seems to me that when we talk about reform of housing finance, we're talking about more than just doing something with Fannie and Freddie. So that's my question is, again, the softball is, you know, what should be the reforms that we need in the financial sector, really, including housing finance?
Okay, well, it should be obvious from my initial comments that the major reform would have to be the Dodd-Frank Act, which is, as you know, I think, is very troublesome. And the reason why we have had such a slow recovery from the recession that we had beginning in 2008 and extending through the early part of 2009, it's been the slowest recovery since the 1960s. And so there's a reason for that. I don't think it's Obamacare. I think it is, in good part, Dodd-Frank. So I would address Dodd-Frank. One of the things that we talked about is illiquidity in the credit markets right now, and that is caused by Dodd-Frank, I think, particularly the Volcker rule, which takes out of the credit markets a lot of people who would normally be making markets there, increasing spreads. This is one of the effects that I think Dodd-Frank has had. In the housing area, however, my experience and my research, to the extent I've done research and thought about these issues, says as long as the government is going to be involved in housing finance, we are going to have exactly the same problem over and over again, because it is the easiest thing for the government to do without any budgetary effects directly to reduce underwriting standards in any number of ways. That's what exactly is happening right now, because the government wants to stimulate the growth of the economy by stimulating housing. So what do? They reduce underwriting standards so that more people will be able to buy homes. It's a temporary effect, because in the end, the cycle will always turn, and when it does, people will start losing their homes, and we will have tremendous losses in the economy. It depends on how big the bubble is that the government creates. So my point that I will continue to make, to the extent I'm involved in the housing debate, is simply we have to come to the conclusion that the government has to step away from the housing finance market. And that's why it's going to be very difficult to get any solution until we have a resolution this whole question in 2016, when a president is elected, because the House is where it is, it's going to want the government out. The Senate committee is not going to probably adopt such legislation, and Dick Shelby, I think, is not going to want to spend his time on something that's hopeless in the 2 years he has as chairman of the banking committee there. So we're not going to have any resolution of Fannie and Freddie or housing. If the election comes out the way I hope it comes out in 2016, then we might have some leadership from a president who will say, let's go back to a world in which mortgage underwriting standards are set by the private sector, because the most natural way for that to work would be to have solid, sound underwriting standards.
Bert served up such a nice softball. I want to give each of the other members of the panel a chance to swing at it if you want. What would your top housing finance reform be looking forward from here? And we'll just go down. John.
I would liquidate Freddie and Fannie and return to a private market in housing finance. It would actually reduce risk significantly in the banking sector. Home finance done properly is one of the lowest risk assets you can have. I've been in the mortgage business since the early 1970s. When I went into the mortgage business, there was Freddie and Fannie were peripheral players. There were no players. We had no problem finding private outlets for mortgages. Most of them went to life insurance companies, which had a perfect fit for home mortgages. It was 20% down, and the loss ratios were basically zero. When banks can't have that asset, and we also held about 20% of those assets, which we were able to manage from a risk perspective because there was no credit risk, but we also had variable rate commercial loans to offset from a risk perspective. We had a lower risk balance sheet than we have today because home financing done with proper down payments and proper understanding is the lowest risk financing you can do. And also, local knowledge of markets is incredibly important. One thing that happened, and this I would support Mark's claim, the whole disconnect of the actual purchaser from local real estate markets. And local real estate markets are huge factors. It matters a lot to understand the local market. And that loss of information, which Freddie and Fannie do and the whole institutional market did, it's not trivial. It's huge. Because you can see bubbles coming locally very easily where you might miss them on a grand scale. So I'd get rid of Freddie and Fannie. I'd return to a private market. I think a lot of banks would portfolio a certain percentage of the mortgages. Some of them would go to life insurance companies. And there would be an institutional market, but it'd be underwritten rationally because the market wouldn't do what Freddie and Fannie do. And competing with Freddie and Fannie at the time as they were trying to meet these goals was pulling down the standards for everybody. Because what were you going to do? and it was bringing down the pricing on the good mortgages. So it was really clouding the whole market phenomenon.
Thanks, Jim. Mark, your top reform going forward from here?
You know, Alex, I'm going to pass. That's a really big question. And it would take me a while to answer, and I've already talked a lot. So unless you really want me to go into it, it's...
We'll give you 1 minute if you want to make
there
a
you
summary
go.
Statement.
Yeah. I'll pass. Yeah.
Dan.
I mean, I've written extensively on it. I'm an open book. You can find out exactly what I think, but I don't think it's conducive for me to, in 1 minute, try to figure out how to. Yeah. Okay.
Luckily, I can do it in 10 seconds.
We're not giving you any goals for what you have to say here, Mark, right? Dan.
Look, I, speaking more as a citizen than an SEC commissioner, I think enactment of Jeb Hensarling's PATH Act, I think it's called, would be the first and foremost thing that the government could do. Because I do believe we have to completely disentangle, some would argue, that even as aggressive as the PATH Act is, it doesn't do enough to disentangle, but boy, would it be a great, amazing step forward. I believe with, as the commenter, the questioner asked earlier, that the entanglement across financial services with the housing industry is something we can't forget. And every now and again, there is an intersection for the SEC. And I lived it up close and personal. And one little rule, the so-called risk retention rulemaking in Dodd-Frank, the skin in the game rulemaking that we just went final on last year, where we had a little role to play at the commission, but we were one of the regulators in the mandated pool of regulators writing rules. And boy, did I get an up close and personal view of the mortgage complex, as Peter calls it, bipartisan, loud, and victorious, unfortunately, even in that rulemaking, where now, after that rule, after enacting rules pursuant to that mandate, we have something in the CFR, the Code of Federal Regulations, called a qualified residential mortgage that requires 0% down. I just find that, after this crisis, this book, any other book you want to read, remarkable.
It is indeed. Okay, next, I had another question over here, and then I'll come over to you, Michael.
Hey, guys. Dan Indaviglia. I'm the Washington columnist with Reuters Breaking Views. So my question, one thing I was surprised not to hear anyone here talk about, one of the potential cause, which I think it satisfies sort of a lot of people, right? You have a villain here, which is government and regulators, and you have an explanation that helps to satisfy Mark's global problem that we saw, is capital requirements, and where mortgages kind of landed in that during this time period, right? You had, kind of framed by Basel, you had mortgages that required very little capital and no real risk weighting for a long time, where you could have an 800 FICO score, a 500 FICO score, and you had to hold the same capital. A lot of the same thing could be said of MBS that eventually became, you had very little capital needed. And this helped create the demand, I think, on the part of the private banks and the investors and whoever that created this problem. So I wondered if, Mark and Peter, maybe John, had any thoughts on that aspect.
Okay, how about capital? Peter, since you're the author, we'll let you go first, and then we'll let others come in.
I go first? Oh, okay. Thank you. The this is a fascinating question because it goes right to the heart of the role of regulation. My view is that the capital requirements that were imposed by Basel herded banks into mortgages, which turned out, maybe because the banks were there, but maybe just for all the other reasons we've talked about, government policy and so forth, turned out to be the worst investments they could possibly make. And that says a tremendous amount about regulation itself. We know that we cannot foresee the future, obviously. But one of the ways we know we can combat the problem of being...
Actually, only some of us know that.
Was it Yogi Berra who said, you can't foresee... there was a wonderful phrase that he had. Yeah, everything, it's hard, especially about the future. Okay. It's hard to make predictions, especially about the future. But the one thing we know that works is diversification. And companies that are able to diversify are much stronger in dealing with the unknowns in the future. And what regulation does is it reduces diversification. It narrows the kinds of things that companies do when they think about the world from their own particular perspective. So they're all doing about the same thing. And so when some kind of event occurs, like we had in 2008, where mortgages fell apart for a variety of reasons, financial institutions were, especially regulated financial institutions, were terribly hurt by that. So if that's a partial answer to your question, that's what I would say, that we have to be very careful about allowing capital requirements to change the nature of what especially regulated banks are required to invest in.
Okay, we could have a whole conference on capital requirements, of course, and have. But the other quick comments on capital?
I actually mentioned this in my presentation, that in fact, the fact the Fed had a 50% basically for subprime mortgages versus 100% for a loan to Exxon, of course that distorts the allocation of assets. And it had the same requirement for an A-plus grade mortgage and an F, a subprime mortgage. So, of course, it distorted the allocation. I know I personally had to fight that. We, BB&T, fortunately didn't have a single loss in the quarterly in the financial crisis, but it was awful tempting to put more high-risk mortgages on your books because you had to have half the capital in that regard. And it helped pull down the real capital in the industry. If you look at one thing that was going on, this was in the private market, but it was driven by government regulation. Banks were dropping their capital ratios, and they were putting a bunch of low, quote, risk home mortgages and MBSs on their books. And the capital ratios of the industry collapsed in a certain sense, but because the Fed set those ratios in a way that incented subprime lending effectively.
Okay, good question. I'm going to come over to Michael.
Michael Barone with the American Enterprise Institute in Washington, Examiner. Peter, you've presented a picture where the wrongful mortgage practices, as we say, fed into the financial crisis. But one of the ingredients, as I hear you and the other panelists talk, is imperfect, very imperfect, information. We have Fannie and Freddie executives accused of fraud, what amounts to fraud. We have Commissioner Gallagher conceding against institutional interest that the SEC might not have done the best job of setting up the rating services and aligning the incentives of rating services with buyers rather than sellers of securities. We have the commentary on Basel II, which you just made. It seems to me you've argued we're moving forward doing the same thing with low interest mortgages and so forth. I've got a nephew that's settling on one on Friday, as a matter of fact. That has the potential, it seems to me, to do a lot of damage in the way you described to neighborhoods. It has damage in terms of cost to the taxpayers and perhaps the balance sheet of some of the financial institutions. But if information is far less imperfect, if we reform those aspects, is it as likely to produce the kind of financial crisis that we saw in 2008 as it turned out to be in producing that crisis.
Yeah, I think actually, Michael, that's correct. If we'd had better information, it's much less likely that we would have had a financial crisis. But one of the things that I mentioned in the book, and I actually mentioned just briefly in my talk, Fannie Freddie did not disclose the mortgages that they were holding. They described them inaccurately as just their holdings of subprime loans were minimal or less than 1%. Well, the SEC is trying to prove something like that. We'll see whether they actually succeed. But yeah, don't ask him. He won't tell you. But this is really important, because if you were someone in charge of the risk management of your firm, you would be unable to describe how risky it was to buy subprime mortgages if you didn't know that the market actually contained two or almost three times as many subprime mortgages as was being reported at the time, because Fannie and Freddie were reporting their mortgages as prime. So it is a very serious problem. It's hard to quantify, of course, and I didn't try to do it, but it is a serious problem if you don't have the accurate information to make these kinds of judgments.
I gather a few market from reading Michael Lewis, a few market players did figure it out and made a lot of money on the basis that you know, there was a lot of rot
that,
in that, MBS.
That in itself is very interesting, because this is a fascinating book, Michael Lewis's book on this subject, because people were given the opportunity to make huge profits for very little investment, and they did not believe that the market was actually going to collapse. These were people on Wall Street who you'd think were sophisticated enough to know what, or to at least have some sense that the market, this big bubble that was occurring, was going to collapse, and they refused to make the bet on credit default swaps, which would have made them very wealthy. It was only a very small group who were willing to do that.
One of the characteristics of bubbles, Michael, is a lot of people are right in the long run, but they're wrong in the short run, and they go broke taking positions which are right as the bubble goes on, characterized by the famous line of Keynes, the market can stay irrational longer than you can stay solvent or employed, for that matter. I'm going to take one more question.
Alex, can I jump in on that just for
yes.
Just, this is
then we'll come
line.
To you, Mark, will be the last question.
Because information is power, and even free market folks like me can get their heads around disclosure that empowers investors, right, forcing these disclosures. One of the rulemakings we did last year at the SEC was called Reg ABS, asset-backed security, the notion being that if you disclose at a loan level with respect to RMBS, the loans, that you would not have a situation like the Big Short again. Guys like Mark and others could parse this and crunch these numbers. This was one of the issues where we homogenized these mortgage pools, where the rating agencies got it wrong, where to John's point, you didn't care about the local conditions, the lumping of zip codes and things like that. But of course, Fannie and Freddie loans are carved out of that disclosure.
This, just a comment, before our last question, which is this topic actually links to the international question we were debating before, which is a lot of countries, of course, in history, there have been plenty of bubbles, but other countries in this bubble had housing bubbles of a very severe kind, but they didn't seem to be as bad. I believe it's true to say that the United States is the only country that tries to promote affordable housing through easier credit or lower credit standards. A lot of countries have subsidy programs, low-income housing or public housing or social housing, as they call it. But I think we're the only country that did the experiment of trying to do this subsidy, pushing it through credit or through poorer, riskier credit. And I think, as Peter's book makes clear, that this was a bad idea. I'm going to take one more question.
I'm Mark Brickle from Clear Markets Holdings. Congratulations, Peter, and thank you for a great book, and not only for writing it, but for being right before it happened and warning us all that it would. And thanks to AEI for holding this revival meeting. I thought it would be good at the close to check back with our agnostic, Mr. Zandi, and ask him, your skepticism about Peter's conclusion sounded in part to be because you thought he was placing too much blame and responsibility on Fannie and Freddie. But now he's joined Mr. Barone and others in pointing out that the capital requirements of the banking supervisors stimulated investment in housing by the very private market participants that you've said were implicated here. Do you come closer to accepting the thesis that government involvement in the mortgage business was a principal causative factor when you think about the fact that they were stimulating not only Fannie and Freddie, but also the private sector participants?
So my interpretation of your question is, have I been brainwashed by this event? No. I think I answered Gene's question about government's impact on the marketplace, and I think there's a lot of truth to that, and it's manifest in many ways. I mean, I'll give you one example that sticks to my mind. That's Alan Greenspan's famous arms speech, a call to arms, and that was right before subprime arms took off. So I'm not arguing that, you know, government hasn't played a role, and more importantly going forward, that we shouldn't rethink government's role in our housing finance system, in our financial system more broadly. I totally concur with all of those things. I just don't think that that's the best explanation, the most likely explanation, the most clearest narrative of what happened. And it is, as Peter points out in his book, and he's dead on, we have to get the narrative right if we're going to get policy in the future right.
Thanks, Mark. Because Peter Wallison is the author and the prosecutor, we're going to give him another minute for his closing appeal to the jury.
Well, I really do appreciate the attendance here, the people who came to listen to what I had to say about the book. I am concerned that it will be very difficult to get others to take the book seriously. My experience in trying to find a publisher for the book was that many people said, oh, well, gee, another book on the financial crisis? What they did not understand, and what they still do not understand now, I think, is that there are really two narratives about the financial crisis. There's the one that we hear every day that was quoted, it came from the Secretary of the Treasury, it came from Gretchen Morgenson. The private sector created the financial crisis. Not enough people understand that there is another and very important narrative, and I'm hoping that this book will get that kind of attention so that we'll have a more balanced view of what occurred in 2008. Because the view we have today is leading us in only one direction, and that is for more regulation of the private sector. Every time a problem occurs, there'll be more regulation, as there has been, until we no longer have the vibrant, innovative economy that we have always been very proud of. So my statement to all of you, if you've enjoyed this conference and if you get the book and read the book, you might tell your friends. maybe we can finally get the media and others to take these ideas seriously, so the debate that we have in this country is balanced between one side and the other, maybe between Mark and me and 1,000 Marks and 3 me, whatever it is, we will at least have a serious debate on this issue. So that's my closing remark, and thank you very much, all of you, for coming.
Thank you, Peter. Ladies and gentlemen, we'll adjourn to a reception next door. We hope you buy the book. Peter will be here to sign them. Thanks for coming.